Good afternoon. Welcome. I'm Cami Stephens. I'm the Executive Director for the Michael and Neal Singers. I welcome you this afternoon for the very first concert of our historic 30th anniversary concert season. Today, I'm so pleased and grateful that you've chosen to come and be a part of I Hear America Singing. We have a lot of people to thank for this production. I want to name the Georgia Council for the Arts. This program is sponsored in part by the Georgia Council for the Arts through appropriations of the Georgia General Assembly. And GCIA also receives money from the National Endowment for the Arts. Partial funding for this program is also supported by the Fulton County Board of Commissioners. And MOS also receives support from the Audience Building Roundtable, which is an initiative of the Arthur M. Blank Family Foundation. Thanks also to Roswell United Methodist Church, our host for today. You can find information about RUMC programs in your pews. There's also a concert series and choirs for all ages here, so I invite you to check that out and visit their website at rumc.com. We have 19 recordings to our name, and many of them are for sale out in the lobby to my right. If you didn't get to go in that way and look at those, I invite you to check that out on your way out today. In addition, you can purchase tickets for future MOS programs. You can see a list of those programs on the inside of your print handbill today. Next up is Christmas Joy on December 2nd, the Sunday afternoon, right back here in this room. And we'll have our special guest, Atlanta Symphony Brass Quintet, with us again. That'll be their sixth time on our concert stage with the full MOS chorus and kaleidoscope ensemble. Now, if you would kindly silence your cell phones, and if you're using a camera, turn off your flash. And I invite you to sit back and enjoy I Hear America Singing. Thanks again for being here this afternoon.
And so let me start out by saying, and you can see this now, that is not my picture on the program. We were getting some calls at the office saying, wow, Dr. O'Neill has had heart summer. But no, it is not. I'll tell you more about that in a moment who is on there. My wife Judy and I have had the opportunity to travel around the world quite a bit over the years. And we have seen so many beautiful places, so many beautiful cities, so many beautiful countries. But I must say, we are always happy to be able to come back to America, to the United States. I think Dorothy said it to Toto in The Wizard of Oz, there's no place like home. And it's true, there is no place like home. And one of the things that makes America so very special is that when we are at our best as a country, we are open to races, ethnicities, religions, different points of view. That's what this country is based on, and as I say, when we are at our best, that is who we are. The picture on your program is Walt Whitman, probably the finest American poet who has ever lived, lived during the 19th century, the Civil War, and around that time. He loved the American people. He wrote a rather lengthy work entitled Leaves of Grass, and one of the poems in there is I Hear America Singing, the varied carols I hear. Walt Whitman believed in the common man. He believed that there is worth and dignity in every person, and that poem is about that. He honors the people in the different professions, especially what we would call blue-collar work today, but the average person and what he or she did. This first piece that we are singing is entitled I Hear America Singing, and it uses that text along with Walk Together Children, a very well-known spiritual. So those two are wedded. Beginning of our concert, I Hear America Singing. He wrote the text, and a perfect person to write the text because, as I mentioned before, Walt Whitman believed in the common man. He was full of optimism and love for this country. The piece, a jubilant song, was written by Norman Della Giorno, a composer especially active around the mid of the 20th century. And he wrote a jubilant song using that Walt Whitman text in 1946. If you know your American history, you know that that was a time of celebration because the war, the Second World War, was over. It was a time of optimism and looking forward. And so you hear that not only in the words that Whitman had written a century before, but in the music that Norman Della Giorno wrote. It has a real tour de force piano part. There are not many pianists who could play it, but luckily we have at the piano Tom Aldrin, who definitely can. A jubilant song. Thank you. Our national anthem, the Star Spangled Banner, became our national anthem. And this is a surprise to many people, not until 1931. But before that, there was another song that was sort of the de facto national anthem for about 100 years, because it was first written in 1831, 100 years before. And it is My Country Tis of Thee. Hail Columbia was another one that was sung in some parts of the country. There was no official national anthem, but those two pieces, and especially My Country Tis of Thee, sung to the tune that the Brits use for God Save the King or God Save the Queen. And so it is a wonderful piece, and I, since this is I Hear America Singing today, I have to hear you singing, so I invite you now to stand. The words will be on the screens. Let's sing together. The dream for the world was that there would be just governments everywhere, and that we would live in a world of peace following that horrific war that took place in the 1940s. And one of the things that Randall Thompson was thinking about as he wrote this was that it was also to honor Serge Koussevitzky, who was celebrating his 25th anniversary as the conductor of the Boston Symphony Orchestra. But certainly in the back of Randall Thompson's mind, and this is true with all composers, composers live in the world that exists around them. And it is rare that you will find composers who are not affected in one way or another by that. So once again, just as with Norman Delajoie and what he did with the Jubilant Song, there was optimism, but also hope that rulers would be just.
Must be just.
The next two pieces are by the same composer, Randall Thompson, who just wrote The Last Words of David. And they're from a collection entitled Frostiana, a number of poems by the very fine American poet Robert Frost. The two that we are going to be singing are probably the best known from that collection of settings by Randall Thompson. The first is The Road Not Taken, and as is the case with any fine poetry, there can always be different interpretations, but I think most people interpret it to mean we have choices in our lives, and sometimes the choice to do a certain thing, to go a certain way, will have an impact on the rest of our lives. And so that text is all about the road not taken, which I could have taken, but took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference in Robert Frost's words. And the next one is Choose Something Like a Star. And it suggests to us that we should find something on which to center our lives, to focus on something greater than ourselves. For some people it is religion, for some people it is a higher purpose in their life, but something beyond themselves. Choose something like a star that stays, that is forever bright and does not diminish. Two beautiful pieces by Randall Thompson.
Thank you.
We come next to an American composer who is probably about as American as any composer could be. His name is Aaron Copland, and he wrote Appalachian Spring, Billy the Kid, things that, that many people might recognize hearing them, even if they don't recognize the titles. But he wrote an opera. Started writing it in 1952, it was completed in 1954. And for those of us who go back a certain amount of time, we may remember that in the early days of television, there were lots of, in the 1950s, there were a lot of live shows, a lot of live productions, Playhouse 90 and that sort of thing. So it wasn't live on tape, but it took place there, usually in studios in New York. It was broadcast to those few people who had TVs around the country, and they could watch it as it was happening. The Tender Land, an opera by Aaron Copland, was intended, NBC commissioned him to write it, and they were going to show it on live television. They opted not to do that for whatever reason, and so it was never shown on TV, but it did receive some subsequent performances in opera houses. But it was never intended for that. It was meant for more of an intimate setting, such as a TV sound stage. There is one piece, however, that has really continued to live from this opera, and that is The Promise of Living. It is at the conclusion of Act One of The Tender Land. And the story, without really going into it, it concerns a depression of family living in the Midwest. And Aaron Copland had been, even though he wrote this in the 50s, he had been very influenced by photographs of the Dust Bowl and the Depression and all of the what people were going through in the middle part of our country, in the farmlands, in the ranchlands. And he had been so touched by photos that he saw from that period of time that it influenced him greatly. In this one scene, in the Promise of Living, it is just a reminder, and especially for people who come from the land, of the importance of the land, of the crops, of the sun and the rain, and all that keeps life flourishing. And it's a beautiful piece. If you have not heard it before, I hope you enjoy The Promise of Living. In 1893, a young college professor named Catherine Bates was traveling by train through Colorado to go do a summer teaching assignment at a college there in Colorado. And en route, she stopped, the train stopped at Pikes Peak. And she had the beautiful view. She'd been seeing beautiful views already, but she saw the beautiful view from the top of Pikes Peak. And it so inspired her that she wrote a poem. And that poem is today a song we sing entitled America the Beautiful. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of rain, for purple mounted majesties of the fruited plain. She saw America, the beauty of America, as she traversed the country. And it led her to write a song that has become for many what they wish the national anthem was. Because it's much easier to sing than the Star Spangled Banner. And you are going to sing it now. Stand, please, America. Is it an opera? Is it an operetta? Is it a musical? musicologists and experts do not agree, and Leonard Bernstein never really made it easy for anyone to know what it was. He said, it's just what it is. Listen to it. And it's based on the story, Candide, by Voltaire, the 18th century philosopher and writer, a cynic, questioned an awful lot of things. And this story, it's a very, very involved story. Don't worry, I'm not going to try to tell it to you. But at the very, well, the main character is Candide, who is searching for meaning. His goal is to find what is life all about. And the story takes him all over the world, a series of misadventures. There's everything. There's, romance, there's murder, there's mayhem, there's sex, there's everything. So it's, what not to like in the story. It has everything. And his love is someone named Cunegonde. And they are separated early on, and she also goes through her whole series of travails. At the end, they are reunited. And the very end of the opera is the piece that we are going to sing for you now. It's entitled Make Our Garden Grow. They have grown old. The blush of youth has passed them. What they fell in love with at the beginning no longer exists in the outward. But they realize that they are still meant for each other. And what they also recognize, after searching for the meaning of life everywhere, going everywhere, what is it all about? The big philosophical question that has been asked for centuries. They decide it's just to be where they are and to try to make some sense of their life as it is, and just to make their garden grow. Stephen Foster is a name that I would think all of us would recognize. He is sometimes recognized also as the father of American music. There was certainly music before Stephen Foster. However, he was a well-known composer and wrote a lot of songs that were called minstrel songs at the time and parlor songs, because people used to, they had pianos and they would play songs there in their parlors. And so he's known for "O Susanna" and "Camp Down Races" and "My Old Kentucky Home," favorite of mine because I'm Kentucky. But my favorite song by Stephen Foster is one entitled "Hard Times Come Again No More." And it was his attempt in writing this song, knowing that it would be played at pianos in parlors, living rooms around the country, to awaken in the American public a sensitivity to those who were not as fortunate as they. So as you listen to these words, know that his true intent was to try to awaken people to the fact that there are others living around us who are less fortunate and need our help. The men will be singing that. And then the next song is a folk song, beautiful folk song, entitled "He's Gone Away." The ladies will be singing that, and it is a typical theme for a folk song, especially an American folk song, because it has to do with separation, which happens so much in the early days of our country. So often the man needed to go off and either to war or to settle new places, but there was separation, and that's what this one is about. First, "Hard Times Come Again No More," and then "He's Gone Away."
There's
would be difficult to think about doing a program of American music without at least one spiritual. And so we have that for you next. It's entitled, Let Me Fly. And as you listen to the words, it will certainly, the words are very, very clear, very apparent. Let me fly over Jordan, in other words, to heaven. Let me get out of this, because you think about the folks who were singing these songs, these spirituals, and certainly the lives that they were leading were nothing that they desired. And so it was about freedom to the other side. But, and many of you know this, I'm sure, already, but it was not just a freedom from this earthly life, but so many of the spirituals also had a secondary meaning, or hidden meaning, that meant something to the slaves, but not to their masters. And that was making it to the north, to freedom. It's where the Underground Railroad came in and all of that. And so there are many times key words and signals in the spirituals. This one is not quite as apparent as that, but certainly as you listen to it, know that many of the people who sang it would have also been thinking about the other side being the other side of the border, to freedom. And then we'll sing another folk song. We'll sing He's Gone Away. We're going to sing probably one of the best loved folk songs of all time, and that is Shenandoah. It has multitude of meanings. Some people think of it as a place, and some people think of it as a person, Shenandoah. And as is the case with so often with folklore, no one really knows for sure. But without a doubt, what it is talking about is a separation from something that is loved, be it a place, which is what I tend to think, or be it a person. And so much of that took place in the early years of our country. Separation that, in many cases, people knew they may never see each other or see the land in which they grew, in which they grew up, may never see it again because they were headed west for hopefully a better life. So, Let Me Fly and Shenandoah.
Oh, let me fly.
They sang, they played instruments, they entertained themselves. What a wonderful thing to think about. And so I encourage you, as you are listening to this, put yourself back in time. Imagine that it's a barn dance, and we are singing this song. Now, I'm not encouraging you to sing along. Please understand that. But get into the spirit just short of adding sound to what we are doing. But it's a different time, a different place. Simple, not necessarily what we would want to go back to, but just that joy of music making for your own amusement and your own amazement. That's a pretty wondrous thing. Cindy.
Yeah.